Well, good morning, church. It's great to be back. 7 weeks in the UK is enough for anybody. And here we are back again, so it's really lovely to see you. I'm conscious of the fact that I'm following John and Judith, who did a great duo sermon last week. And I thought that will be hard to follow until I realise that it's not me that's having to do it, because the Spirit will help me. So shall we open in prayer? Dear Lord Jesus, we just thank you that we can come in your name and worship you. Lord, we so want to worship you this morning. And we pray that you, your Holy Spirit, will enter each one of us. Give me the words to say, Lord. Well, on August the 23rd, I sat down to write this sermon. Beforehand, I prayed that the Holy Spirit would inspire me to give you and I the words we need to hear. I thought that I should possibly carry on with James, because if you remember a few months ago, I did James 1, and then I did James 2, and then I did James 3, and it seemed logical that I should do with James 4, and eventually James 5. But in my mind, I was aware of the state of our nation, and it just kept niggling at me, and our world, and how depressing the news is every day. So I thought, should I mention the end times? The thought for the day, that in my Bible reading that day, was Psalm 102, Corinthians 15, and Chronicles 18, and it was entitled, Trust God to Do It His Way. Trust God to Do It His Way. And I want to preach about that this morning. The previous 2 weeks have been spent with, among others, our dear friends, Mick and Tricia Warrior. Mick and I have been friends for over 50 years now. Sue had her 70th birthday. Everybody knows.
Trouble now.
Everybody knows. And we celebrated with friends and family at a nearby lovely restaurant near Malmesbury, where we've got home. 17 of us in total, and 10 days later, we, Mick and Tricia, Sue and I, celebrated our golden wedding anniversary at Rick Stein's famous restaurant in Paxton, Cornwall. And everything seemed glorious, or was it? Well, yes and no. We still face massive problems in our country and in our world, so what can we about it? And that's what I want to think about this morning. First and foremost, trust God. Trust God to do it His way. As I have told you previously, if you're a member of this congregation, Mick was a Church of England clergyman. Well, he was a telecommunications engineer before that, and he was my apprentice for a while, and I was privileged to bring him to the Lord, and he became a Church of England clergyman. He's now retired. And he has spoken to me several times about some of the funerals that he has conducted. And one of the most popular funeral songs, he tells me, from non-Christians that is Frank Sinatra's I Did It My Way. And it just, when I was thinking about this, a load of names came into my head. Al Capone did it his way. Adolf Hitler, Joseph Stalin, Vladimir Putin, I did it my way. If we as Christians look back on our lives, what will we say? I did it my way. I trusted in my brain, my ability to get it right, or I trusted in God to do it His way. In 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 12, it says, we do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. When we are faced with seemingly insurmountable problems and situations over the years, and maybe even presently, how do we react? Is it, I did it my way, or is it, I trusted in God? So how does my trusting in God to do it His way actually work? What do we have to do? Well, firstly, it is surely about prayer. Our lives are scattered with battles and blessings, every single one of us, including our Lord with us here on earth, battles and blessings. And one of the things that impresses me most about me and Trisha Bullion is that they pray together every day. And he kept telling me over the last 2 weeks we were together about praying together every day, man and wife, if you can. I know some people can't. And he said, how can we trust God if we don't talk to Him every day? I want to look at Psalm 102, 12 to 17, and Sue's going to read it for me.
Psalm 102, verse 12. But you, Lord, sit enthroned forever. Your renown endures through all generations. You will arise and have compassion on Zion, for it is time to show favor to her. The appointed time has come. For her stones are dear to your servants. Her very dust moves them to pity. The nations will fear the name of the Lord. All the kings of the earth will revere your glory. For the Lord will rebuild Zion and appear in his glory. He will respond to the prayer of the destitute.
Prayer, then. What good is it? Charles Spurgeon said this: prayer is the slender nerve that moves the muscle of omnipotence. In other words, your prayers enable God, your prayers are responded to by God doing something. You might not see it, but it happens in omnipotence. The all-powerful God listens to what you say. Listens to what you say. When we see the problems in our lives and our nation, what is your first response? Do you do this? You're watching the news, it's horrible, and you say, I can't stand it anymore, I can't bear it, I'm turning it off. I have to admit that I've done that on more than one occasion. But in the psalm that Sue just read to us, the psalmist looks out at the mess in his city. His first response is not to say, oh, woe is me, I can't cope with this. He cries out to God. He extols God for both his power and his love, declaring his greatness. And as we look around our nation today, the UK and other countries, I see so many churches closed or closing or failing in numbers. Not all, Mike, not all. HTB and the plans seem to be full, and I'm grateful for that. But God has the power to rebuild His people in every country. God has the power to open up all those churches again. I wonder if we believe that, or are we just sort of, well, you know, our country, that's it. Do you therefore pray for revival? Do you meet with somebody else that's a Christian to pray these things through? It's easy to imagine, of course. But do you meet with other Christians other than on Sundays to pray? When Sue and I were young and handsome, beautiful, well, Sue's still that beautiful, it's just me that's not handsome anymore. But we used to listen to an evangelist called Philip Hackey. He was vicar of Fulwood. There are two massive churches in Sheffield where we originally. One was Fulwood and the other was St. Thomas Crooks, where Mick Warren was the vicar for a long time. And Philip Hackett used to regularly advocate that his congregation attend midweek fellowship. So the Christians could meet together to pray. I remember well him saying, if you are too busy to meet the fellowship in midweek, then you are too busy altogether and you need to change your lifestyle. So how about us? Do we go and pray in midweek with the fellowship, or are we too busy with worldly things? I can't come on Wednesday morning because I'm playing battle. I can't come on Wednesday morning because it's the preacher's corner. I can't come on Wednesday because it's wine appreciation. There are 82 activities in the U3A now. I've mentioned just three of them too. How can we change the world if we can't be bothered to meet and pray together? How would you feel if one of your children decided not to speak to you? Because that's how God must feel, isn't it? Because we are his children. And if our children don't speak to us, we don't like it very much. I wonder what we've done wrong. Nicky Gumbel said this. Nicky Gumbel, vicar of HDB, just retired a couple of days ago, actually, and was replaced by a man called Archie Cox. And he said this, Nicky Gumbel: you can be confident in the power of God to answer your prayer. It is not that you can control God's power by your prayers, but that God is always acting in the life of his people and his world. He attends to prayer. He attends to the prayer of the wretched. He won't dismiss their prayers. That's Psalm 2 verse 17. So let's move on then. What is the great promise our God gives to his people, to you and me? I want to give you an anecdote to try and illustrate this. Recently I had a blood test at Mark's Beacon surgery. And whilst I was in the waiting room, I watched several very old people come and go with their Zimmer friends and some with their carers. They were very old indeed, they were even. And it was a bit depressing. Or it would have been without our great promise. A promise to those who are God's children. I know that this is the right message to give this morning, because in the middle of me actually writing this sermon, I got a FaceTime call that I wasn't expecting from my friend who I preached, who I talked about, who I prayed about when we had the open prayer. He said to me that his body is right with cancer. I knew that he'd got cancer of the prostate. And I knew that he's been kept alive by tablets. And he's got no testosterone left. And if you're a bloke, that's not good. And he said he didn't know how long he had to live. He's not a believer. I walked with him on the U3A walks for years, and then he went back 3 years ago now to London. He doesn't like him. His wife's not very well, she's dementia. I've talked about my faith before, but he wouldn't have any of it. We were great friends. I mean, he likes football, and so do I. So we used to talk about all sorts of things. So why am I telling you all this? I'm telling you all this because I want to think about the great promise. I want to think about whether we tell other people about the great promise. I want to read 1 Corinthians 15, and it suits me to do it. It's quite heavy, but it's bits in it that talk about the great promise. And I'll come back and tell you what I said to my friend, and I'll relate it to this Bible passage.
So, 1 Corinthians 15, verses 35 to 49. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body will they come? How foolish. What you sow, doesn't come to life until it dies. When you sow, you do not plant the body that will be, but just a seed, perhaps of wheat or of something else. But God gives it a body as he has determined, and to each kind of seed he gives its own body. Not all flesh is the same. People have one kind of flesh, animals have another, birds another, and fish another. There are also heavenly bodies, and there are earthly bodies. But the splendor of the heavenly bodies is one kind, and the splendor of the earthly bodies is another. The sun has one kind of splendor, the moon another, and the stars another. And star differs from star in splendor. So will it be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam, a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural, and after that, the spiritual. The first man was of the dust of the earth. The second man is of heaven. As was the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are of heaven. And just as we have borne the image of the earthly man, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly man.
First listen to it, it seems quite heavy, but he's talking about the great promise that we have. He's talking about the fact that our body is perishable, and that the older you get, the more you realise that's so. But the promise is that it's not the end of it, because Jesus was resurrected, and so will we be, with a spiritual body that is far better than anything that we got here. So how do I tell that to my friend? How do you tell it to other people without them thinking that you're bonkers? Because some of them do, don't they? I mean, I am a bloke in world, I like football, and you know, I come from Sheffield, and a lot of my friends don't know the Lord, and if I'm not careful, I can switch them off. And I got the courage to actually talk to this friend in London. And they did it by WhatsApp, and I'll tell you what happened. But I wanted to talk about the faith, but I was very worried about how I could do that. And I put this to him. We talked about football, I talked about football to start and perhaps still more. And then I said, when you rang me yesterday, I was halfway through writing a sermon to the Spanish church, which I will deliver on the 4th of September, God willing. And as I sat and listened to you talking about your illness, I felt very sad. You are both a lovely couple and we miss you on the Spanish walks. I was actually looking at a bit of the Bible talking about life after death and a spiritual body. When you talked about, I have cancer everywhere, I don't know how long I have to live. My heart bled for you. Please forgive me for what I am about to write. It is about the Christian faith that Sue and I follow. I desperately don't want you to think that I am bonkers, apart from the fact that I am a lifelong Sheffield United supporter, and that's bonkers, isn't it? The thing about our faith is that the end of this life is not the end of it. I was in Exeter Cathedral last week, which is beautiful, a beautiful architectural building with the largest vaulted ceiling in the world. There were many plaques on the wall. One was paying tribute to a well-loved man. He said this, and I'm paraphrasing. He lived his life well, and at the end, he was released from the pain, which he accepted gladly. Death had no terror for him. He has gone home. I thought long about that. Death has no terror, because the end of life is not the end. The Christian faith is about love. 1 Corinthians 13 is often used at weddings because it epitomizes love and the Christian way. Verses 4 to 7 say this: love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, love is not rude, love is not self-seeking. Love is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. And these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. We believe in life after death. It is a gift to those who choose to accept it. It promises an existence far better than the cruel world has to offer. It restores hope and emanates love. If you feel you want to know more, then you can find out by watching the Alpha series, and I gave him the link. Going back to that plaque just for a minute. He went to his death without terror. I have been at several people's death bedside. And one used to be a member of this congregation a long time ago. Not many of you will. I think we've only Glynis would know her, a lady called Sheila. And her, Glynis's husband, spent loads of time with her. And when we went, she said to us that she was frightened. She'd been a Christian all her life. We were able to share with her that she needn't be frightened. There was something glorious to look forward to. And we have to do that. I don't know how many of you have watched The Vicar of Dibley, but it's a true story. The Vicar of Dibley, it's about a true vicar. And she had in her congregation a woman called, it was Florrie Shaw. They did a bit on it. Florrie Shaw is a fantastic, humble Christian. And she had to face, this is a true story, she had to face an operation, and they said that she might not survive him. And she knew that. Well, she did survive him. And as she woke up after the surgery, the doctor was looking at her. And she was so confident and so humble that she looked at the doctor and said, "Hello, God, I'm Florrie Shaw." She was so humble, she thought God might have known who she was. But she was so confident that there's a life after death. There was no terror for her. And here's the important thing. Because of the resurrection of Jesus, you can trust that God will raise you in his own way, and that will be far better than anything that you can imagine. I believe in spiritual life. I was with my father-in-law years ago as he was dying. I was the only one there. The rest of our family had gone for a coffee. We didn't know he was going to die. And I felt his spirit leave his body. It was amazing. And I know where he is. Here's the important thing. Because of the resurrection of Jesus, you can trust God will raise you. I believe in the spiritual life. I think there is a life that we cannot see. I did maths and physics at university, and I believed that there were things like electrons. I can't see them, but I don't put my fingers in the plug hole because I know the electrons will let me know that they're there. So I believe in something that I can't see. It's the same thing. I believe in the spiritual body. That's what our great promise is. that we will be resurrected to a better life. And we need to believe and accept that. Jesus was still recognizable to his followers after his death.
And with the words of the last song that we sang before the throne of God above, maybe still ringing in our ears, I'd like us to move into a time of communion by reading a passage that was actually preached on 2 weeks ago by Barbara Chadwick. It's Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19-25. You may remember that Barbara spoke about lettuces, but it was actually bringing our attention to the bits in this passage that say, let us, lettuces. She's got my kind of humour, I think. Anyway, Hebrews 10, 19-25. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. I think it's a great passage to start a communion service, because it sums everything up. He is our great high priest, and that's why we can come to God. And thank you everybody for coming to meet together. We have indeed followed that lettuce today. Let us not give up meeting together. And so, let's approach communion by coming quietly before God to confess our sins, whether through thought or word or deed, through things that we've said or done, or things that we should have said or done but we didn't. And so in a moment of quiet, let's just prepare ourselves for communion. And so this coming week, let's resolve to put those things right with God's help that we've just asked forgiveness for. Our communion today is going to be based around the communion hymn, which was written by Stuart Townend and Kristen and Keith Getty, Behold the Lamb of God. So could we now have verse 1 of that song?
Forgiveness at the cross, so we shall. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the King.
We remember his words as he took the bread and broke it, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you." And now, as Judith's going to take around the bread, when you receive it, take it, we're going to share that bread together as we sing.
The body of our Savior Jesus Christ, torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love around the table of the King.
Took the cup. And we can just picture them around that upper room, that table together. And Jesus standing in front of them. And after giving thanks, he said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." It was the blood of the new covenant. No longer needed a priest or high priest to enter. We could come directly to God through the death of his Son. So let's sing verse 3 as the cup is passed around, but please would you retain the cup and we will drink together. So can we have verse 3 please?
The blood that cleanses every stain of sin shed for you. Drink and remember, he drank his cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread.
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we not hold on to this precious gift, but let us now go out into the world
So with thankfulness and faith we rise to respond and to remember our call to follow in the steps of Christ as his bride.